In video one of this section, we explained how the cardiac depolarization and repolarization waves spread through the chambers of the heart. In this video, we will go on to explain how these electrical events are analyzed by the ECG leads to produce the waveforms of the ECG readout. To record an ECG, 10 electrodes, referred to as leads, are placed in standardized positions on the patient's body, as shown here. The information obtained from these electrodes is processed by the ECG machine in a way which allows it to analyze the movement of electrical forces through the heart from 12 different perspectives around the organ. The readout from each of these 12 different perspectives, also referred to as leads, is printed landscaped on an A4 piece of paper, as shown here. In this way, the ECG recording can give us information about disease processes affecting different anatomical regions of the organ, and can detect changes in the pattern of spread of electrical forces through the heart in disease. We'll see how this works later, but for now, we need to understand how an individual ECG lead analyzes and records cardiac electrical events. In any ECG lead, the flat line recorded on the readout when no net current is flowing in its direction is termed the isoelectric line. It is very important to realize that all of the leads on the ECG machine are set up in such a way that depolarizing current moving towards a lead produces a deflection on the ECG paper above the isoelectric line, a positive deflection, while depolarizing current moving away from the lead produces a deflection below the isoelectric line, a negative deflection. In contrast, repolarizing current has the opposite polarity to depolarizing current. Therefore, repolarizing current moving towards a lead produces a negative deflection on the paper, while repolarizing current moving away from the lead produces a positive deflection. ECG paper is divided into large squares of 5 mm in height and width, and small squares of 1 mm in height and width. In a standard 12-lead ECG, the sensitivity of the machine is set at a level such that 1 millivolt of these electrical forces moving directly towards or away from a lead produces a deflection of 10 millimeters, that is 10 small squares, in the readout from that lead. As the depolarization and repolarization waves spread through the normal heart in a well-defined and relatively constant pattern, these rules mean that if we know the perspective of an ECG lead on electrical events in the heart, we can predict the form of readout it records. We'll come back to the nomenclature and perspective of all 12 leads later, but for now let's see how this works in two of the so-called chess leads, V1 and V6. Lead V1 is placed on the anterior surface of the patient's chest in the fourth right intercostal space, to the right of the sternum and therefore to the right of the bulk of the ventricles. In contrast, lead V6 is placed on the patient's chest in the fifth intercostal space, mid-axillary line, and faces the heart from the left of the ventricles. The atria sit at the back of the chest cavity, and during each cardiac cycle, atrial contraction is associated with a wave of depolarization spreading through the walls of these chambers. We'll deal with atrial depolarization in some detail in different sections of this course, but for now, remember the SA node is situated towards the back of the right atrium. So the atrial depolarization wave not only spreads downwards and to the left, but also outwards towards the front of the chest and towards the chest leads. As this depolarizing current is moving towards the leads, it produces a positive deflection on the ECG paper. This is the P wave of atrial depolarization. After a short delay in which no current is flowing, the AV node allows the depolarization signal to travel into the ventricles. As we've seen, the depolarizing current is first released from the left bundle branch of the conducting system into the interventricular septum. This is the first piece of ventricular muscle to depolarize, and it does so by signal spreading across the septum from the left to the right bundle branch. This early depolarization signal is moving towards V1 and therefore produces a positive deflection on the ECG paper in the recording from this lead. However, this septal current is moving away from lead V6, producing an initial negative deflection in this lead. As the septum continues to depolarize, the depolarization wave is released from the terminal fibers of the conducting system into the main muscle mass of the ventricles. To understand what happens next in the recordings, it is important to appreciate that the magnitude of the electrical signal generated by depolarizing muscle is directly proportional to the mass of muscle generating it. What this means is that the more muscle present, the more electrical signal generated, and the more signal the ECG machine detects. The left ventricle has a much greater muscle mass than the right, and so dominates the electrical signal of ventricular depolarization in all leads. Therefore, after release of the depolarization wave from the conducting system into the main muscle mass of the ventricles, the subendocardial to epicardial movement of current in the left ventricle overwhelms all other signals, and as it is moving away from lead V1, the deflection produced on the ECG recording from this lead becomes negative. In contrast, however, this signal is moving towards lead V6, producing a strong positive deflection in this lead. The flow of depolarizing current around the ventricles is recorded as the Qrs complex. And as we've just seen, the morphology of the Qrs complex differs predictably in the ECG leads, depending on their position relative to the heart. We'll come back to the precise nomenclature of the Qrs complex in a later video. When ventricular depolarization is complete, there is a brief period when no current is flowing, and the recording returns to the isoelectric line. This period ends with the onset of ventricular repolarization. Remember, repolarizing current has the opposite polarity to the depolarization wave, and therefore, when it is moving towards a lead, it produces a negative deflection on the ECG paper, and a positive deflection when moving away from a lead. We've also seen that repolarization spreads through the ventricles in the opposite direction to the depolarization wave, beginning in the epicardium and spreading from the epicardial to the endocardial surface of the ventricles. The deflection produced on an ECG by ventricular repolarization is again dominated by the signal from the left ventricle. As this repolarizing current is moving towards V1, the deflection produced is negative in this lead. In contrast, this repolarizing signal is moving away from lead V6, producing a positive deflection. The deflection produced by ventricular repolarization is termed a T wave. Note that the T wave has a very different morphology to the Qrs complex. Cardiac repolarization spreads relatively slowly through the myocardial muscle mass outside the conducting system. Hence, the T wave is considerably longer in duration and therefore broader on the ECG paper than the Qrs complex. You should also realize at this point that the fact that repolarizing current moves through the ventricles in the opposite direction to the depolarization wave means that in leads with an overall positive Qrs complex, that is, the positive deflection is larger than the negative deflection, the T wave also tends to be positive, lying above the isoelectric line. While in leads with an overall negative QRS complex, the T waves are also negative, inverted below the isoelectric line. To use the jargon, in non-diseased hearts, the QRS complexes and T waves tend to be concordant. There are important exceptions to this rule, which we will deal with shortly. Just to tie up a loose end, atrial repolarization produces a relatively weak electrical signal, which is buried in the QRS complex and is generally not detectable on a standard 12-lead ECG.